Thank you for tuning in to another episode of Healthy Soul with Coach T. I'm your host, Coach T. What a beautiful, beautiful Sunday afternoon, and I hope that you and your family are having an amazing day. If you are not following me on social media, I ask you to follow me on Instagram and Facebook at Simplistic Solution RLC. Please follow me there. I post some great content daily that I hope will help you to get through this thing called relationships. Look, relationships are not easy, but they are worth it. Not only that, life management and relationship management go hand in hand. We need to learn how to manage our relationships. So today I want to talk about something that is very familiar to most of us. It doesn't matter whether you are a Christian, a believer or not. All of us have heard of the serenity prayer, and it goes a little something like this: God, grant me the serenity to accept the things that I can change, the courage to change the things that I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. But when I thought about this yesterday, I actually did some research to discover the full version of this, the original full version of this prayer. And the original full version of this prayer was actually done by the theologian Reinhold Niebuhr, and I hope that I'm pronouncing his name correctly. It was attributed to him. And the full version of this prayer says this: God, give us the grace to accept with serenity the things that cannot be changed, courage to change the things which should be changed, and the wisdom to distinguish the one from the other. Living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as the pathway to peace, taking as Jesus did the sinful world as it is, not as I would have it, trusting that you would make all things right if I surrender to your will, so that I may reasonably happily enjoy this life and supremely happy with you forever in the next. Amen. And so I want to talk about the serenity prayer, because we always seem to quote just the beginning of this prayer. Lord, help me to accept the things that I can change, the courage to change the things that I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. And when I looked at the original version of this, I prefer the original version of this more. Why? Because the original version of this prayer is in more direct alignment with how the will of God and the plan of God functions for our lives. Why do I say that? Let me read the beginning of this one more time. God gives us the grace to accept with serenity. What is serenity? It is the calm and the peaceful control or uncontrolled, unbothered. It is in other words, the bossed and unbothered belief or way of doing things that cannot be changed. So in other words, it is having the peace to accept what I can't change. The courage. What is courage? The ability to have strength in the presence of our pain, in the presence of our fear, in the presence of our grief. The things which should be changed, not just the things that I think I can change. See, that's the problem with many of us. We want to change the things that we think we should change. But should those things be changed according to the will of God for us? The question is, should they be changed according to God's purpose and His plan for our lives? That becomes the question. And so it is having the courage to change the things that should be changed according to God's purpose and His plan for our lives. And it requires courage. It requires understanding that there is a grace available from God. There is a strength that is available from God, that we obtain in the presence of God, that is not absent from fear. That's why it's a grace. It is a strength that is obtained that may still be in the presence of our pain, in the presence of our grief, even in the presence of our fear. That's why we need grace to do it. But it gives us the courage to make the changes that we need according to the plan of God for our lives, and the wisdom to distinguish one from the other. What is wisdom? Wisdom is a quality of making good, sound judgment calls based on our experiences, our knowledge, and the leading of the Holy Spirit. Now, some of us may not be in relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, and so we trust in our good, sound judgment based on, I've been this way before, based on, I've had enough life experiences to know to not make this decision again. I've had enough mistakes to know that I don't want to make this decision again. So wisdom is making good, sound judgment calls based on those experiences, based on the knowledge that we have, based on information that we have obtained from others who have gone the same way and who have cautioned us to not go the same way. So it's the wisdom to distinguish one from the other. So when you put that together, it says God gives us the grace to accept with serenity the things I cannot change, or the things that cannot be changed, courage to change the things which should be changed, and the wisdom to distinguish one from the other. See, in this thing called life, we need serenity, we need courage, and we can't do it absent of prayer. We try to do life and don't have peace. We try to do life and don't have courage. And we try to do life and don't have prayer. And the reality is, we need all three. We can't navigate life without a sense of peace in our inner being, in the depths of our soul. When our soul is in chaos, when our soul is disturbed, when our soul can't find a place of peace and rest, then we're all over the place. And we make decisions that will align with the chaos that is happening on the inside of us. And then what happens from that? Then we discover a place of regret. We make decisions that will later cost us. And then we ask ourselves, why? Why did I make that decision? How did I get here? Well, we arrived at that place because we were not in a place of serenity. We was not in a place of peace when we made those decisions. Some of those decisions are made under pressure. Some of those decisions are made in duress. And that's why we need to look to the Lord for wisdom. We need to look to the Lord to give us peace. We need to look to the Lord to give us instructions so that we don't make decisions from a place that is unhealed, that is unhealthy, from a place that we're not whole, that we will later come back and regret the decisions that we made. The more decisions that we make from a place of soundness, from a place of peace, from a place of internal wholeness and completeness, the more that we will be okay with our decisions in the long run. Guess what? They may not always still be the right decisions, but we can make those decisions knowing that we made them from a healthy and whole place. Life is full of experiences. We can't get around that. And guess what? We're grateful for it, because those decisions that we make, that even when we determine that they weren't the best decisions, we learn from them and they make us the better in the long run. Let us continue on with what this serenity prayer says. The second part of this prayer says, living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace. Now, here's the problem. We don't live one day at a time. We don't enjoy one moment at a time. In other words, what the writer is saying here is that we're living in the present. Many of us can't enjoy life in the present because we are consumed with planning what our long-term future looks like. Now, should we have a plan? Absolutely. Should we look to our future? Absolutely. Should we have a 3-year or a 5-year plan for our lives? Absolutely. But why can't we enjoy the moment? Why are we so consumed with our future that we can't even begin to plan what our now and what our moment now looks like? We can't enjoy the present with friends and family because we're so consumed with the future. Being so consumed and obsessed with the future robs us of enjoying the now. As a matter of fact, for those of us who are believers, the scripture says now faith is the substance of things that are hoped for, the evidence of things that are seen. Guess what? We need to operate in the now, even when we are preparing for the future. We're preparing for the future because we are standing in the now. We see where we are in the now, and so we look at that and we say, you know what? Let me prepare for the future because I am standing in the now. And so guess what? We want to be able to embrace people in the now. We want to enjoy relationships in the now. If we are in relationships with people, romantic relationships, if we are in relationships with family members, with friends, we don't want to rob them of enjoying us now because we can't be present in our now. That's robbing the relationship. That's robbing ourselves. Who wants to be in a relationship with anyone, not just romantically, but anyone, and not give of ourselves completely in those relationships? I'll be honest, I don't. I don't want to be in a relationship with anyone, friends or romantically, and I can't enjoy who you are today. Relationships are reciprocal. And so guess what? I want to be able to give, and I also want to be able to receive. I don't want to give of myself and who I am to you, and then you can't give of who you are to me. They are reciprocal, and relationships are best enjoyed when we reciprocate. If we enter in a relationship thinking that we can only give, that's already problematic. Like, really, who made us God in the relationship? Nobody did. And so if we see ourselves in a relationship that way, then the relationship is already in error. We need to enter relationships knowing that it's give and take. All right? That the relationship is not 50-50. The relationships are always, hear me and hear me well, whether it's marriage or whether it's a interpersonal relationship, relationships are always 100% on all parties. So I don't go into any relationship, interpersonal, romantically, familia, whatever the case may be. I don't enter into that relationship thinking 50-50. I go into the relationship wanting to give 100% of who I am in the relationship. If we enter into the relationship saying that I'm only going to give based on what they give, then why enter the relationship? It doesn't make sense to me. No, we always give the best of who we are. And if we enter into the relationship giving the best of who we are, and then the other person is not giving the best of who they are, guess what? Then maybe we need to make some other choices, make some other decisions. Even in that, we need to woman up, man up, and have conversations about what we're doing. So let's go on to the other part of this prayer. Accepting hardships as the pathway to peace. Accepting hardships as the pathway to peace. This means that, guess what? Life comes with hardships. There is no way around it. We want to live a life that is void of hardships, that a life that is void of problems, a life that is void of lessons. Life is a classroom, and that's the way I like to say it. Some people will never go to college, but make no mistake about it, they will earn their PhD, if you will, through the classroom of life. Life is full of circumstances. Life is full of situations that is faithful to teach us when we are willing to lean in and learn. And so when we are willing to lean in and learn, when we trust God, then we can accept through the hardship of life the pathways to peace. Why? Because we trust in a God who knows the thoughts and the plans that he thinks towards us. Now, God does not necessarily, he does not cause bad things to happen to us. But what he does is he does what his word says. He make all those bad things work together for the good of them who loves him and are called according to his purpose. So when the bad things in life happen to us, he is faithful to take those things, to turn them around and make them work for our good. I can think of many bad things that have happened to me in my life, but I haven't charged God for them. But what I have done is I have taken those things and I have said, God, how can I use this to reach more people? How can I heal from these things? How can I heal from these adverse things in my life and become more transparent to use them to help others? That is how I have accepted the hardships in my life, walked in the pathway of peace, and used them to help others. We have to be willing to accept hardships as the pathway of peace and then turn them around and help others. Guess what? It's not just in me, it's in you, but it's a choice that we make. We can either take those things, go sit in the corner and die from them, literally, or die emotionally, die spiritually, or we can rise up in the power of God, in the newness of God, in our relationship with God, and we can say, Lord, you know what? You promised me that you would make all these things work together for my good, and because I trust you, I trust that you're going to make these things work out for me. So show me how I can use these adverse actions in my life to help others. And guess what? He will empower us to do that. He will show us exactly how to do what? To do that. Now, guess what? In some of those things, we may have to get past some shame. We may have to get past some guilt. But guess what? We can do those things. I can do all things through him who gives me strength. So if I need to take some time to get past some shame, to get past some guilt, do all those things, work it out in the presence of the Lord, work it out with him, and then come back stronger, come back wiser, come back healthier, so that we can help others. The Bible says this: when thou art converted, then strengthen your brother. A lot of times we take that conversion to just simply means when I go from not being a believer to accepting Christ in my life. But no, when I am converted, when I am healed from, when I go from a place of brokenness to a place of healing, when I go from a place of being delivered from one thing, from out of one thing into a place of healing, when I go from being in a place of guilt to being in a place of being healed from that, when I go from a place of being in a place of extreme shame to being in a place of happiness and joy and being healed from the shame, how about strengthen someone else? There are many other people out there that have struggled with the same things that we have struggled with, and we've been delivered from some of those same things, but we won't go back out and strengthen other people. And my question is why? My question to you today is why? We say we aren't still in shame, but we won't share our testimony about where we've been delivered from. Ask yourself why. Ask yourself why. We need to help others. The scripture says they overcame by the blood of the Lamb and by the words of their testimony. The blood did its work over 2,000 years ago. We recently celebrated the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. When we understand what the power of that resurrection means, when we truly understand it, we understand what it means for our lives. See, nobody can hurt me with the testimony when I share the testimony of what I've been through. Nobody can hurt me with that. I understand what the power of his resurrection means for my life. So nobody can hurt me with my testimony. I tell it myself. I've been through a lot of stuff. I'm not ashamed of it. So you can't hurt me with it. God has healed me. He has delivered me. I've been through many things. As a matter of fact, one of my primary sayings is, I am not my sister's keeper. I am my sister. I feel her pain. I identify with her pain. I know many of the things that she feels, many of the things that she goes through. and I can't identify with her if I'm too busy being ashamed of what I've gone through. So let's share our things. Let's heal from them so that we can help to deliver others. Let's go on with the rest of the prayer. Taking as Jesus did, this sinful world as it is. Look, the world is as it is. The world as it is broken. The world as it is hurting. If people don't know our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, then they are hurting. Why are we so shocked by what people do? They are hurting as we were hurting, and some of us are still hurting. But grace goes a long way. I like to say broken crayons still color. People still have value, even in their brokenness. And so we can't confine people to the fact that just because they have not accepted the Lord, we can't discount them and we can't discredit them that they're nothing and nobody because they haven't accepted our Lord. See, the Lord loves his creation so much so that he went to the cross for them. He went to the cross for me. You don't believe me? The Bible says that while we were yet sinners, that Christ died for us. So just because I have come to accept him, there are many people that have not come to accept him. But the word of God says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So guess what? With that same loving kindness that he drew me, I want to exemplify the same loving kindness that I may draw others. Hey, it's paying it forward. We want to talk about paying it forward. Paying it forward is not just what I do when I'm at Starbucks or when I'm at some other coffee house or when I'm at McDonald's or when I'm at some other restaurant and I pay it forward for the person that's in front of me. How about paying forward loving kindness? Because it's what drew us to the Father. Pay it forward. Let's not look at those who have not yet accepted our Lord and Savior and count them out. He died for them the same way he died for us. He extended grace. Look, when I was in the club doing the thing, let's just be honest here. When I was in the club doing the thing, I wasn't having a bad time. I was doing the thing. I was in that club. I was having a good time. Couldn't nobody tell me nothing. I was looking forward to it every week. I was having a good time. I wasn't making a bad salary doing it. I was doing the thing. But then I had something that happened in my life that really tore my heart into shreds. And it was in that place that I found the Lord. So most people are in their lives and they're enjoying their lives. And so we can't be mad at people because they don't choose to accept Christ where they are. No, we show love and kindness to them right where they are. And we trust God to extend some mercy and some grace to them. And we keep loving them right where they are. And we ask God to be merciful to them. And we keep ministering to them right where they are. See, the thing about relationships is relationships, and the root word is relational. So where can I relate with them? Where can I identify with them right where they are? And that's the part we don't want to do. Some of us have reached places with our relationship with the Lord where we think that we are too saved and too holy and we're too sanctified and we're too separated to identify with the brokenness of humanity. Oh my God, we're not too saved to identify with the brokenness of humanity, that we can show empathy. We are quick to say, look, I feel sorry for you. But we are slow to say that I identify with you. I am empathetic. That's what empathy is. Empathy is I identify with you. I walk in your shoes. I can identify with where you are. I can identify with what you feel. As a matter of fact, I can identify with you because I walked in the very same identity. See, it's easy for me to walk with the woman that is broken from divorce because I am she. It's easy for me to walk with the woman who has children that have gone wayward, because I am she. It's easy for me to walk with the woman who has considered suicide, because I am she. Who is it easy for you to walk with? It's not just easy because you've walked and you've walked with Christ all your life. No, 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 no. You've done some horrendous stuff. You've been some weed smoking, cursing, drinking, shoot 'em up, bang, bang. Whatever you've done out there. Don't forget those things. Those things have been the very things that would allow you to identify with some other people. To let them know, guess what? Yeah, you did those things. You've done those things. But you're still loved by God. If we are out here teaching and preaching a gospel of condemnation, that's not who he is. He is a God of love. With loving kindness have I drawn you. I'm so glad that he drew me with loving kindness. I'm so glad that he sent messengers to me with messages of love. When I was broken and hurting in my office, there were people who came to me. This is before I even knew who he was. There were people who came to me with messages of love, who wanted me to know how much God loved me, who wanted me to know how much the Lord loved me. And they came to me with messages of love. So guess what? That's all I have for people. It's the message of love. I'm not here to tell them how bad they are. Guess what? I blow it sometimes. But what I know is that God is merciful, that God is love, that he is kind. Does he want us to get it together? Absolutely. He died for us to get it together. But what I know is that he is full of grace and truth. And so who am I to preach and to minister messages of condemnation? I won't do it. That's not who I am. I'm here to encourage hope. I'm here to let people know that there is a better way. I'm here to let people know that you're greater than anyone ever told you that you were, and that there's more to you than you ever knew. And the problem is that you have not yet discovered the fullness of your greatness. You have not discovered the fullness of the impact that you are yet to make on humanity. And guess what? You will, because I believe in you. You're going to do it, and I know you will. So when we come back, we're going to go into the second half of our show. Stick with me here on Healthy Soul with Coach T. We're doing the thing.
La-da-da-da-day, you're not breaking me. La-da-da-da-da-da-da. Somebody told me fame is a disease. You start seeing the blues when you start seeing the green. But I think it's all about what you choose. The way you live your life depends on you. That's when I realized I wanna make a difference. Change other people's lives, give hope even for a moment. Use my name for good and change the game I could. Just to make it, you think I gotta act a certain way. Be a little bit insane, live a little, it's okay. I guess we have different definitions of living, but you'll twist my words anyway. Say that I'm naive, like I don't have a past. You're the one being deceived, I see right behind the mask. Trying to stir me up and get me mad. That's not because happiness is all I have. So, la-da-da-da-day, you're not breaking me. In a bubble, you'll find me at church, but that don't mean I can't cause trouble. Stir up a little scene, cause isn't that what you want? For me to mess up so you could dress up some story, saying Tori, this will sell more records. But I'd rather make them yawn than be a pawn on your chessboard. So call me boring, call me cookie cutter, call me what you want. And matter of fact, just say it loud and don't stutter, cause I know who I am. Yeah, I'm still the same, just a California girl with big dreams, thinking maybe they'll let me sing songs about real things. And baby, who knows, maybe I could sell out shows without out, taking off my clothes. God made me sexy, I don't care if only I know.
Praying, dying, and things stay the same.
Thank you, and we're back for segment two of Healthy Soul with Coach T. I'm your host, Coach T. If you're not already following me on Facebook and Instagram, please do so at Simplistic Solutions RLC. Thank you for following me if you are. I look forward to dialoguing with you on those platforms. In our first edition of, first segment, if you will, of Healthy Soul with Coach T today, we were talking about the Serenity Prayer. And I actually want to read this prayer one more time for those who are just joining us. The original prayer says, God, give us the grace to accept with serenity the things that cannot be changed, courage to change the things which should be changed, and the wisdom to distinguish the one from the other. Living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace, taking as Jesus did the sinful world as it is, not as I would have it, trusting that you would make all things right if I surrender to your will, so that I may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with you forever in the next. Amen. And so I was speaking of this prayer in that how many of us only read the beginning of this prayer in the revised version that says, help me to accept with serenity the things that I can change, the courage to change the things that I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. And how when I decided to take a closer look at this prayer, how I came across the full version of this, which was extremely different. I wouldn't say extremely, but it was definitely different. And then to see the full version of this prayer, which is much more reasonable, in line, I should say, with kind of the will of God for our lives. And so before the break, I left off with reading how it talks about accepting hardship as the pathway to peace. We have to be willing to accept hardship as the pathway to peace, and understanding that hardship actually guides us into wisdom about how to navigate life. So once we go through hardship in our lives, it should give us some wisdom in how to make better decisions going forward. It says, as I go forward, taking as Jesus did the sinful world as it is. Look, the world is as it is. It's not perfect. The world as it is what it is. And so those of us that are believers, we are here to evangelize the good news. And the good news is that Jesus loves us and that Jesus saves. The good news is not death, hell, the grave, and condemnation. And so those of us who are believers and followers of Christ, we are here to remind the world that Jesus loves them and that he died for them. He died for all of us, that we might come to know him in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. And so we want to make sure that we are communicating a message of love and not making people to be afraid of him. We don't want to communicate a gospel that is controlled by fear. And somehow, some way, that's what we have unfortunately did as a body, as the church of the living God. We have communicated in many ways a gospel that is fearful. And so what I have tend to heard from a lot of people is, oh, I don't want to play with God, or oh, I'm going to come when I get my life together. Well, if we could get our life together, then there would not be a need for a savior. He is the savior of the world. And so if I could get my life together, then why would I need a savior? And so we're not talking about, quote unquote, this white Jesus that I hear people talking about. Look, the Jesus that I serve, he's not about color. He is about souls. He is about loving people and bringing people into a place of love and acceptance and knowing that he has great thoughts and a great purpose for their lives. And so this is the person that I would like to introduce people that I know to. As we go on in the Serenity Prayer, it says, not as I would have it, trusting that you will make all things right. He will make all things right. And one of the things that I have learned, there have been many people in relationships who have hurt me, who have done wrong by me, who have offended me, and I don't have to do the same thing to them in return. One thing that I can trust is that the Lord God will make all things right in my life. Now, does that mean I want him to do something harmful to them? Absolutely not. I want him to be merciful to them. Now, if I'm completely honest, was there a time in my life that I wanted to say, Lord, I want you to get them? Absolutely. I would be lying to you if I did not say that my humanity did not kick in and I wanted him to get them because I wanted them got. That's just the truth. And so one thing about me, I'm not going to tell you the truth. I'm not going to sit behind this microphone and not tell you the real deal and the real talk. No, there were times that I wanted them got. But at the end of the day, that's not God and that's not love. And I want my heart and my life to align with what my beliefs are. And I believe that God is a God of love. And so that I want him to be merciful with those that has wronged me. Here's what I understand. What I understand is those that have wronged me is that, one, that there is something going awry in their heart, which is why they wronged me. And so guess what? If you ask some people who I deal with, they probably would say that I've done some things to offend and to wrong them. And I think that sometimes we miss that. We think that we would like to say that everybody has done us wrong. Everybody has mistreated us. But if you ask some of the people that we deal with, they probably would have the same testimony towards us. We don't consider that, but that's just the reality. Ask some of the people who deal with us. Ask some of the people who engage with us day to day. Ask some of our coworkers. They probably would have the same story, the same testimony concerning us. At the end of the day, we all need grace. And if to whom much is given, much is required. And I know in the church, we like to use that towards money, but we have become a capitalistic, not just society, but we are a capitalistic church. But in that text is not talking about money. If you read the preceding text, it's talking about grace. To whom much grace is given, much grace is required. And so if I give grace, then much grace can be, I can expect to receive much grace. Because guess what? I've also offended people. I've also hurt people. And while I can confess that and receive God's forgiveness, then I want to also be one who gives grace to those who offend me. Let's move on in this prayer. If I surrender to your will so that I may be reasonably happy in this life. Look, the safest place that we will ever be is not hiding out in our home. It's not hiding out in a bunker. It's not hiding out in a shelter. The safest place we will ever be is in the will of the one who has called us out of darkness and into the marvelous light. The safest place we will ever be is doing what the Lord has called us to do. The safest place we will ever be is doing what the Lord has called us to do. In other words, it is being in purpose, on purpose. Look, we want to be protected. Absolutely, everyone wants to be protected. And so the safest place is what is that we will ever be is doing what God has called us to do. We want our spouses to protect us. Absolutely. We want people to protect us. Absolutely. And guess what? They can do that. But the ultimate protection that we will have is through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And he is faithful to protect us. He wants us to be in his will. His thoughts and his plans are so good for us. And so he wants us to be in his will. So we would only know his will by getting in his presence, by asking him, what is our will for our lives? And guess what? It varies from person to person. Not everyone is going to be called to pulpit ministry. Not everyone is going to be called to stand and to declare from a platform the word of the Lord. But as servants of the Lord, we are all called to tell others about the goodness of the Lord and the goodness of the Lord and how he has been good in our lives. That's just being a servant of who he is. And so I had to find my place. And while I can stand in someone's pulpit, and I have, and I can stand and evangelize out on the street, and I have. But where I found my place is when I'm just in a small group of people telling people who they are in God and confirming and affirming and encouraging people about who they are, what their purpose is, and telling people that the Lord loves them, helping people to walk to a place of healing and wholeness, and walking people through to becoming from a place of brokenness and into a place of a healthy soul. That is my purpose and my calling in the Lord. So whatever your purpose and whatever your calling is, doesn't have to look like anyone else. But knowing who you are and what you are called to do, that's where you will find happiness. That's where you will find your place of joy, is being happy in who God has called you to be. Being authentically happy in just that place. Guess what? When you find that place, you will find a sense of being complete, a sense of being whole. Wholeness and completeness is not found in another person. It is found in being complete, authentic, in the purpose and the calling of God for our lives. When we find that place, we have tapped into something. And thankfully, I am at a place where I know who I am in Him. I know what He has called me to do, and I'm resting in that. I don't have to compare myself to no one else, because the Bible says that we don't need to compare ourselves by ourselves. In other words, comparing myself to other humans, it's not wise, because I can look at other people, and then what happens is, if I compare myself to other people, then I won't appreciate what God has given me to do. And so what we do and what we make the misstep in doing is we look on social media, we look at what other people are doing, and then we don't have an appreciation for what we're supposed to be doing. And that's not okay. It's like telling God, you got it wrong when it came to me. No, He didn't get it. He didn't get it wrong. We just didn't appreciate it. So I fully appreciate the gift and the calling of God for my life. So whatever your gift, whatever your call is, appreciate that and walk fully in it, unbothered, unapologetically walk in who God has called you to be. Look, I am your host, Coach T. Thank you for tuning in with me today for another episode. Soar, thrive, be who God has called you to be. Live your best life with a healthy soul. And tune in for another episode next week. I love you. Ain't nothing you can do about it. Deuces.
I remember when He saved my life. Everything before that was just a blur. I was wild, living real foul. I just want right. I remember when He changed my name. From sick to healed, from broke to blessed. Now I can testify that I'll never be the same. My God is amazing. Simply truth is, I should be crazy. words, giving honor to God, who's the head of my life. I want to thank you. If it had not been for you, I could have died last year, thinking about the last tears, thinking about the last time that I called on you, and you came through. I remember when my God is